What were you like making your first film? Were you nervous? Did you always know you could do it? Were you ever overwhelmed by the fact that you had these big stars?
I was more overweight than overwhelmed at that time. I think the nervousness made me eat a lot during that process. I was very stressed out. I was very scared. I was very nervous. But I was also humongously excited because I couldn't believe that I actually had a job. And I was making a movie that was going to be released in a theater where people were going to walk in and see my work. I couldn't believe I had an out-of-body experience right through that film. And every time I would can a shot, I would like, I took this shot. This is my scene. This is my movie. These are real actors. This is a real film. This will eventually release. And like, I don't know, but I think this is a feeling all debut filmmakers have. Right. Oh my God, that oh my God moment happened to me about a million times right through that film. Through the turbulence, through the issues, through the stresses, through the budgetary constraints, through everything. It was like, oh my God, this is mine. Like, I couldn't believe it. I still can't believe like I actually did what I did, and I still can't believe I have done what I've done. Like, sometimes you just feel like my life has been a series of happy accidents.
You know, Rani, I remember her saying that you weren't very kind to her when you met her in Mauritius the first day of shoot.
I mean, I was not kind. I was just snatching her food away. So I want to tell you, she had to look like a college bomb, and the prerequisite of a college bomb is to fit into those hot, sexy clothes. And I was like, Rani, you got to lose some weight before you come. And she said, yeah, I will lose 4 kilos. And when she reached Mauritius, she had put on 4 kilos. So I don't know what had happened in the time that I had left her, but clearly she had, you know, kind of had one too many
landing the role.
Excited pieces of dessert. And I was like, oh my God. So Manish Malhotra and me were only monitoring. I called the room service and I said, if this room calls for this, this and this, you will not serve it. So they were like, but we, that's against the rules of this hotel. I said, I don't care. You cannot serve this food. So Rani was like, room service is not sending me food. I'm like, I don't care. You're not eating. For 4 days, you have to just... I mean, I wouldn't do that to anybody today because I firmly believe like you got to own. But in those days, times were different. And you know, today, I firmly believe you got to own your body and love who you are. But in those days, there was so much pressure, you know, that we had for a Hindi film actors to look, a certain way.
Yeah.
And today, I think there are actors that have broken those myths, and I feel like really ridiculous what I put her through because it was like something. And I couldn't afford to talk. You should have seen me at that time. I mean, you know, I was bursting on the seams and giving her advice on weight.
But what did you shoot with her first? What was the first? And then you did, you had to hide her weight and things like that with a bag.
Why are you going on and on? I'll give you a big bag to hide right now.
Might need it.
It's after Rani's waistline.
Okay, let's move on. Yeah. Salman was such an incredible and such a crucial element to that film. But he wasn't someone that you were particularly friendly to or knew when you approached.
No, so Salman, his father and my father were really dear friends. And they had worked together. And we were family friends. But I was always very scared of Salman. Like, I was like, I still am. He's the only artist, I think, that I get very nervous in front of always. And though I have a deep amount of love and respect for him, because I can never forget that he really did my first film. And I have to tell you how it happened. So I went and offered the role first to Chandrachur Singh, and I had an interesting conversation with him over the phone, because I used to live in, I don't know if all of you are familiar with Mumbai, I lived in an area called Malabar Hill. How many of you know what that is?
The posh part for those that don't
know. It was a lovely area, residential area, and he called me and he said, I live, can you come and meet me? I live in 7 bungalows.
Distant suburbs.
Now, but I didn't know 7 bungalows was an area. So I thought that he was showing off and saying he lives in 7 bungalows. So I said on the phone, I said, but which one do you live in? So he said, no, I live in 7 bungalows. And I was like, okay, but which is yours? So he was like, the area is called Seven Bungalows. I was like, oh. And then I realized it was an hour and a half away, and I drove there very excited, narrated the full film to him with gusto and excitement. Then he called me back the next day, and I said, I went with my date diary thinking it's all signed, sealed, delivered, and he said, but I don't want to do the film. My first question was like, dude, you could have told me this on the phone. Like, I've come all the way, like, very far. Like, I didn't have to hear a no after having gone through that whole drive. So anyway, then after that, I went to Saif Ali Khan, and, you know, he heard it again, and he was like, I don't want to play this kind of character. And I was like, now who's going to do, after my whole Rani bout, I was like, I'm going to now begging, and like, you know, I'm going to start going through this whole process. Very depressed, I went to Chunky Pandey's house, who had a house party that night. No, I didn't go to offer him the film. I just went to I went to Chunky Pandey's house for a party. There I met Salman Khan, and he came up to me, and so I was very close to his sister Alvira, and she had told Salman about my film and me, and he's like, so I heard you've been shopping. So I was like, well, I have, and it's not been a very successful shopping trip. So he said, you know, only a stupid, really passionate person will really do this part, and I will do it. So I was like, you, as in Salman Khan, will do this film. And he was too big a star for me to even think that he would. He said, come and narrate it to me the next day. And I went and narrated the film. He heard the first half. And at interval, he told me, he said, I'm doing the film. So I said, but you're in the second half. He's like, I don't need to hear it. I can hear it in your voice. This film I want to do, and I'll do it for your father. He said, not for you, I'm doing this for your father. And I don't think I can ever forget that grand gesture of Salman's, because he just said it with abandon, that I'll do it for your father. He didn't even hear the film. He didn't hear the script. He just did it. He arrived on set. I told him the basic beats. He did it. It was an amazing 12-day schedule we had with him. There was no problem, no stress. He was amazing. Like one of my best actor experiences, and it was just seamless. I can't believe that Salman Khan was in the film. Like, I remember we were away in London when the film released, because, you know, we had some threats at that time, and it was a really scary time, and my parents and me had to run off, and we were in London, and my college and school friends would actually put the phone, those were initial mobile days, would put the phone out with an audience when Salman's entry, because those were also non-social media days, so we actually kept that secret a secret. People didn't know Salman was in the film. And when they arrived, and there was such a loud roar, and I was all the way in London hearing this audience, feeling like I'm going to start weeping because I can't see it. And there I had my mother next to me, who was so paranoid about the threats that she secretly kept saying, if the film works, will we get more threats? And I was like, secretly, is she hoping that the film doesn't work? Because I was like, Mama, it doesn't matter, you know.
How did that film's success sort of change your life?
It changed it completely. I mean, from that lost child looking for like something to do, finding the right direction, pun totally intended, to have made that first film receive the kind of love it did, it was surreal. It was like a dream that had been fructified to perfection. And more than anything else, what really completed it for me was that look on my father's face when he had seen cinematic success after being in the business for about 18 years and only seen failure. That look in his eyes, that just that aura and that energy he had, and the fact that he was so proud that it came to him through his son, through me, that just completed that portrait for me. That whole portrait. It was just made it like it made it everything. Like for me, like, nothing is more important. You know, success, I believe, is transient, as is failure. But I think the validation of your parents is something that is truly, that to me is success. To me, nothing else matters.
You know, why do you think it is a film that 20 years later still has an appeal? Is that something you've thought of? Because, you know, you look at some films, and you look at some films that were very successful in their time, and then you have some distance, and they don't hold up. Sometimes they just feel dated. They feel like the emotions are dated. It feels like the story is dated. You know, the fashion will date. But why do you think this is a film that still pushes all the buttons? It's still a film that you can enjoy, there have been other films since that have done the campus kind of thing, the love triangle again. But this is a film that still holds up and endures so beautifully.
I think the fact that it's It's genuinely, and I don't say that young as an age thing. I think it's a young film because it has, it makes, at any age, it makes you feel alive and young. And it reminds you of your first love. In certain ways, it's lived on only because it's very young. If you watch it today, a millennial will watch it and find something. Yes, the fashion, actually the fashion is all back, right? All the 90s fashion is all back. So in many ways, it's still fashion-wise relevant, but that's not about it. It's every kind of audience will find some kind of resonance with the film. Because at some point, you felt like Anjali. Mm-hmm. Some point you wanted to be Tina. And all Anjali's and Tina's wanted a man like Rahul. All Rahul's wanted to be completed by a girl like Anjali. And I think these are prototype stereotypes that are cliched but very resonant with the people across the world who have watched the film and have deeply identified with it. I think it will live on forever, not because it's my film, it's because somewhere you'll find yourself in that film. You know, whether you're a boy or a girl, a man or a woman, even a parent, you will look back at it either with nostalgia, longing, or deep resonance, one of the three.
You know, there are things in the film, there are moments in the film that are lovely, and I'm also trying to remember the bits that got criticized, you know. Just the whole idea that this is a man who, when he sees this girl, I mean, the basic, you know...
It's politically completely wrong.
Right. You know, Anjali is a tomboy, it can only be a friend. Yeah. There's just no attraction at all.
Totally.
Anjali's in a sari, pallu flies, and suddenly she's a woman.
I'm telling you, it is the most politically incorrect film. And I would never be able to replicate that incorrect politicalness today. Shabana Azmi, I remember, called me. She saw the film in England somewhere. And she said, and I've said this at various times, and she said, "Kya matlab hua? Chote baal the. Ladki ki tarah ghoom rahi thi, to ishq nahi hua. Saadi pehen liya, kapde itne khubsurat ho gaye, baal udne laga aur ishq ho gaya. How dare you allow this? What do you have to say?" So I took a beat and I said, "Ma'am, I'm really sorry." So she said, "Sorry? Yahi kehna chahte ho tum?" I said, "Haan, main aur kya kahun, because you're right. It is totally wrong. But main kya karun? Those were my thoughts at that time. And I'm very apologetic about those thoughts. Because today I don't have those thoughts. Right. I was young, uninformed, and possibly cinematically influenced to a certain stage that it was kind of, we were ticking boxes. A girl was meant to be like this, a boy was doing like, but over the years you evolve, you mature, and you become a far more emotionally sensitive human being, where you're more in touch, you know, you're more liberated, you're more in touch with yourself, your thoughts, your sexuality, your inclusiveness, your thoughts change. But in those days, back in 1997 when I scripted it, I was still playing Hindi film.
Right.
I wasn't really playing. I was playing to the gallery. I wasn't thinking. So all the boxes are incorrect, but the thought and soul is in place. Right.